Good morning to you all. A very warm welcome to the church in Purton and to this service of Holy Communion. We look forward to hearing from Dan today. He is our preacher. So we begin with the greeting. The Lord be with you and also with you. Now we are people who try to put God first in our lives. And we can encourage each other today as we give God our praise. And so we sing our first hymn, Fill Thou My Life, O Lord my God, in every part with praise. Would you please be seated? So it's to say together the prayer of preparation. Lord, direct our thoughts and teach us to pray. Lift up our hearts to worship you in spirit and in truth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Time for the confession. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live and in love and peace with all. We'll be quiet for a moment and think about those things that we want to confess to God. And so together we say, Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought and word and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So we stand to sing the Gloria. Collect for today. Almighty God, you have broken the tyranny of sin and have sent the Spirit of your Son into our hearts, whereby we call you Father. Give us grace to dedicate our freedom to your service, that we and all creation may be brought to the glorious liberty of the children of God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We sit for our first reading.
The first reading today is from Genesis. Some time later, God tested Abraham. He said to him, "Abraham, here I am," he replied. Then God said, "Take your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on a mountain that I will show you." Early the next morning, Abraham got up and loaded his donkey. He took with him two of his servants and his son Isaac. When he had cut enough wood for the burnt offering, he set out for the place God had told him about. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance. He said to his servants, "Stay here with the donkey, while I and the boy go over there. We will worship, and then we will come back to you." Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and placed it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. As the two of them went on together, Isaac spoke up and said to his father Abraham, "Father." "Yes, my son," Abraham replied. "The fire and wood are here," Isaac said, "but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" Abraham said, "God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son." And the two of them went on together. When they reached the place God had told him about, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on the top of the wood. Then he reached out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But an angel of the Lord called out to him from heaven, "Abraham, Abraham!" "Here I am," he replied. "Do not lay a hand on the boy," he said. "Do not do anything to him. Now I know that you fear God, because you have not withheld from me your son, your only son." Abraham looked up. And there in a thicket he saw a ram caught by its horns. He went over and took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, "The Lord will provide." And to this day it is said, "On the mountain of the Lord it will be provided." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you very much, Chris. Now, our next hymn encourages us to organize our lives in a way that is pleasing to God. "Dear Lord and Father of mankind."
Recall the sin our Lord.
think that's it. Not to worry, that's great. I'm sure we did very well on that, didn't we? Well, we remain standing now for our second reading. Thank you.
Second reading is Matthew 10, verses 40 to 42. Anyone who welcomes you welcomes me, and anyone who welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet as a prophet will receive a prophet's reward, and whoever welcomes a righteous person as a righteous person will receive a righteous person's reward. And if anyone gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones who is my disciple, truly I tell you that person will certainly not lose their reward. This is the Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord.
Would you please sit? Dan, would you like to come up and share with us, please? Now, as Dan comes up, I just need to explain that we commiserate with him this morning because he's had a tough time at home, I think, with Noah. He's not been very well, is that right?
No.
Oh, poor chap. He's okay now, is he? He's there.
Yeah.
That's good. Well, we're very glad about that anyway. And you're okay?
Yeah.
Lovely.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
Morning, everyone. I messaged my mum this morning saying, can you please let Henry know I'm on my way? Have you ever done an impromptu sermon if the talker hasn't turned up? You just don't have one. Testing. Genesis 22. What a hard reading to understand and comprehend. Why would God want to test Abraham by telling him to sacrifice his child Isaac? I've often witnessed and been a part of conversations where a non-believer goes, okay, so if your God is so loving, then why does he make people sacrifice their children? And I'm guessing I'm not the only one here that's hit a stumbling block in response, even though we know this isn't reflective of God's love at all. Honestly, if God spoke to me and told me to sacrifice Oliver or Noah, then I'd be asking myself, well, is this really the faith and purpose I want? To sacrifice my children to prove my level of faith? If God asked me to sacrifice my manager at work, dependent on the day, then probably, yeah. We do have to ask the question, though, and delve into the thinking behind why God asked Abraham to do this. Obviously, we know that it wasn't an act to be followed through, else there would be even bigger questions. So then, what do we make of the word testing, or to test? The noun is to action of process, or process of testing or checking someone or something. If I were to single someone out in this room, ask them to name a subject that they know quite a lot of information about, and then go, okay, I'm going to test you in front of everyone. I'm sure I'd still get their heart racing just a little bit faster. The word test isn't always a comfortable one to say and experience. Thinking back to our school days, our GCSEs, GCEs, O-levels, A-levels, did we enjoy doing our tests? No. However, there are also some tests we may enjoy doing as we want to prove ourselves on how good we are. The adjective to the word testing is revealing a person's capabilities by putting them under strain and challenging them. For example, our driving tests. Who here passed first time? Quite a few. Who on their second? Anyone a few more times? Lord, we pray for those drivers at the end of it. How many times? Just a shout out. Three, four?
Three.
Three. Any more? Three. Oh, I heard some at the back then. They do say that the better drivers pass second time round, but I'm not going to go into that. We did want to pass with flying colours, though, just to show how good we are at something. We wish to pride ourselves on some of our achievements. This is exactly why Abraham followed through on God's requests. I want to add that I love through the reading that we hear Abraham say to the Lord, "Here I am." I'll come back to that a little later on. Abraham loved and feared God, and so in his eyes, rightfully followed the commands of the Lord to slaughter his son Isaac. Did Abraham know this was a test? I'm unsure about that. He knew that it was God's will. Did Abraham know how to discern the voice of God? Absolutely. And phew, am I glad he did. We as Christians have to be so careful in listening for the true voice of God when we hear him calling or talking to us. Matthew 24:24 reads, "For false messiahs and false prophets will appear and perform great signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, even the elect." Ezekiel 13:9 supports that by saying, "My hand will be against the prophets who see false visions and utter lying divinations. They will not belong to the council of my people or be listed in the records of Israel, nor will they enter the land of Israel. Then you will know that I am sovereign Lord." Abraham was able to clearly know that it was the Lord speaking to him and trusted in the Lord to do what is right and just, and in this case, sacrificing his child. Yeah, at this point it still does sound a little harsh, because reading the passage, you can clearly see the father-son bonding time initially. I loved reading the part about Isaac asking his dad where the sacrifice was. Abraham's face must have been 1,000 words, just blank face, I'm not going to tell you. Then Abraham thanking his son for helping build the altar, then bound him. It's maybe a good job we didn't see the story from the perspective of Isaac. The chapter would have been called, "That's the last time I go hunting with my dad." If it would have happened in today's world, can you imagine the conversation or lack of conversation that would have happened on the return drive home? Probably a lot of silence, and then Isaac piping up and going, "Dad, do you want to explain what happened back there? I will tell Mom." We don't even get a capture of the emotions around this further on in the chapter. However, what we do get is God providing a ram that was to be used to slaughter as an offering to God. Abraham was a true man of God and a follower of his word to carry out God's will. "Here I am, Lord." And this passage shows the love of Abraham to God and the love of God for Abraham. So it brings me on to the second question. Did God have to test Abraham? Well, I explained the definition of test earlier, and in an adjective sense, we see that it means to reveal a person's capabilities. I think we focus too much on the negative side of the word test. God is omniscient and loving and knows Abraham through and through. God knows that Abraham would prove his level of faith to God by sacrificing his child Isaac. We need to realise that this word test in this chapter is an exploration of Abraham's capabilities as a man of God. I stated that if I was to single someone out to test their knowledge, it may seem a bit harsh or abrupt. What's the point in testing me, Dan? But if we were to think of a leader of a church or job, youth group, what if we were to single someone out and say, "Barry, you are so kind and caring. I see the potential in you and I'd love to challenge you more to see you grow in faith. I want you to become lead in the pastoral prayer team. Jen, you're a bold person and not afraid to approach people. I want to start an evangelism street team." All of a sudden, we are seen to be pushing someone's abilities, encouraging them to do more. I truly believe that this is what God did with Abraham. Does God test us? Absolutely. When we get tested, we want to improve where we fall short or fail. If I'm doing something wrong in my life that I need improvement on, is God going to let me continue on the same path and not introduce learning curves for me or test my faith? Will I be able to transition into a better Christian if this doesn't happen? We need to focus on the adjective definition of the word test and be challenged. Tested by God, but not only to reveal our gifts and blessings, but also to reveal a God-like image in us. God does this in such a loving way because testing reveals what is hidden inside of us. Is it making sense? Is God going to ask us to slaughter our children to prove our faith to him? I don't believe so. I hope not. Because we have to look at the context and timing of the chapter. Abraham and his wife Sarah were at such an age that childbearing would be near enough impossible, and so having Isaac was a miracle in their lives. Again, such faith Abraham had in God that he would go to carry out such an act against his one and only son Isaac. What followed from the testing on Abraham revealed a blessing. Genesis 22 chapter goes on to read, "The angel of the Lord called to Abraham from heaven a second time and said, 'I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as the sand on the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies, and through your offspring all nations on earth will be blessed, because you have obeyed me.'" All of a sudden, after reflecting on the word test, looking at God, why God would ask Abraham to do such a strange and frankly disturbing act, we actually start to see that in fact it was such a loving thing that God placed in Abraham and his family's lives by blessing their families for generations. And time-wise, such an important test, one that would allow generations to be born under Abraham and take us through the story of the Bible. Are we willing to be tested, challenged and pushed by God? And it brings us perfectly onto the second reading, which I think I should read again from Matthew. "Anyone who welcomes you welcomes me, and anyone who welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet as a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever welcomes a righteous person as a righteous person will receive a righteous person's reward. And if anyone gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones who is my disciple, truly I tell you, that person will certainly not lose their reward." Makes sense with Abraham's story now, doesn't it? We often focus on the barriers that may face us if we try something new, trusting the Lord fully and give ourselves to his decision making. It is hard to sacrifice, isn't it? When we know we can praise God comfortably as a church on a Sunday morning, quietly worshipping in our bathrooms, cars, go to our prayer groups, but praise God in public places, however, challenging ourselves by submitting to God and his true plans for us. Scary stuff. Challenging each other, testing each other as a church family, and being obedient to God's calling on our lives, it will bring us so much freedom. James 4:7 reads, "Submit yourself then to God, resist the devil and he will flee from you." Job 22 reads, "Submit to God and be at peace with him. In this way prosperity will come to you." Luke 22 reads, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done." Every week we say the Lord's Prayer, don't we? "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, and your will be done." I'll finish on this note. There's a massive sacrifice we're all aware of. Abraham's testing foretold of this sacrifice. It's the ultimate sacrifice, one that I said I couldn't imagine doing myself. Actually, it's a sacrifice that at the start of this talk, I stated that if I heard God ask me to do it, I'd question my own faith. It starts with Christ, and it ends with Christ. It's the Son of God who died on the cross for the forgiveness of all sins. It's an unconditionally loving God that sacrificed his one and only Son for us. It's the ultimate test, the final curtain call on Jesus' life. The original story of love, loss, pain, sorrow, forgiveness, joy and freedom. It's a God that loves us so much that he made a plan to ultimately sacrifice his own Son to set us free. The final curtain call to which we see Jesus rise from the dead to reveal the plan God has for us. I challenge you to test me, and I am testing you as a church today. Can we sacrifice what we may have good in this life to become more like God? Amen.
Thank you, Dan, very much. That was really helpful. So we're at the part of the point in our service where we affirm our faith in God. Would you please stand? Let us declare our faith in God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Would you please sit? And we're going to ask Margaret now to lead us in our prayers.
When we are called to follow Jesus, that means total commitment with no half measures. Holy God, you have called us to meet and pray together, and here we are. When I say, we ask in Jesus' name, please reply, give us grace to discern your answer. We ask in Jesus' name,
give us grace to discern your answer.
We pray for those called to lay an ordained ministry in your church and for those at present testing their vocation. We lay before you the work that needs doing here and ask you to provide people to do it. We pray for Julia as she prepares to leave us and start her new life at Woomben. We ask in Jesus' name, give us grace to discern your answer. We pray for those called to serve you in positions of authority and influence, for all leaders to see true greatness as service and true strength as humility. We pray for our NHS, which helps so many of us in our daily lives. We ask in Jesus' name, give us grace to discern your answer. We pray for those called to marriage and those called to the single life, for parents and grandparents, sons and daughters, for acceptance of what we cannot change, and strength to live the Christian life in our present situation. We ask in Jesus' name, give us grace to discern your answer. We pray for those whose lives are full of disappointment, disillusion, and discontent, for all those who struggle with great perseverance in difficult circumstances. We pray for your strength, encouragement and direction. Please bring an end to the troubles in France. We think of Nahal's family, the 17-year-old boy who has died. We pray for the troubled areas of the world, especially Ukraine. We ask in Jesus' name, give us grace to discern your answer. We pray for those called through death into eternal life and freedom from all their pain and suffering. Receive them with mercy and welcome them into your kingdom. We pray for the families of the Titan Sub and for the family of Nicola Bully. We ask in Jesus' name.
Give us grace to discern your answer.
We thank you, Holy God, for your promise that where two or three are gathered in your name, you will grant their requests. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you very much, Margaret. So we come to the peace now. Would you please stand? We are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
And we offer one another a sign of the peace. So we come to our next hymn, which really takes us straight beyond what we've heard this morning from Dan, because during this next hymn we ask God to make us the people that he wants us to be. And during this hymn, the offering will be taken. Lord, I come to you. Table before us, nourish your people with the word of life and the bread of heaven. Amen. Would you please sit? The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. Blessed are you, Lord God, our light and our salvation. To you be glory and praise forever. From the beginning, you have created all things, and all your works echo the silent music of your praise. In the fullness of time, you made us in your image, the crown of all creation. You give us breath and speech, that with angels and archangels and all the powers of heaven, we may find a voice to sing your praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. How wonderful the work of your hands, O Lord. As a mother tenderly gathers her children, you embraced a people as your own. When they turned away and rebelled, your love remained steadfast. From them you raised up Jesus, our Saviour, born of Mary, to be the living bread, in whom all our hungers are satisfied. He offered his life for sinners with a love stronger than death. He opened wide his arms on the cross. On the night before he died, he came to supper with his friends, and taking bread, he gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Father, we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. We remember his dying and rising in glory, and we rejoice that he intercedes for us at your right hand. Pour out your Holy Spirit as we bring before you these gifts of your creation. May they be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy things in your presence, form us in the likeness of Christ and build us into a living temple to your glory. Remember, Lord, your church in every land. Reveal her unity, guard her faith, and preserve her peace. Bring us at the last with all the saints to the vision of that eternal splendor for which you have created us, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom, with whom, and in whom, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honor and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. As our Savior taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body. because we all share in one bread. Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. So together we say, we do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table. But you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. Together we pray. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We whom the bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. For our final hymn today, we ask God to help us to bring light and joy and peace wherever we go. You shall go out with joy. Time for our notices, and I think that David is going to give our notices to us today.
Morning.
No.
Not many notices, however. 11 o'clock on Wednesday, communion is here, and Julia, as we all know, will be leaving in September to go to Wimborne. That place a million miles away from here. Out on the table, and there are three documents. One, an invitation to a party. Two, an invitation to her licensing, and a card. If you have not signed any of those, please do so, because time is really passing now. What else have we got? Yes. Anne, my wife, yesterday disappeared for a few hours and came back and proved that she did it. She did 12 laps at Aldersley. And this was in through Wolverhampton Rotary Club for the Coronary Cares New Cross and the Haven. And I know Anne has been sponsored, but will still accept sponsorships for something that she's already done. If you follow me. Right, so there we go. Thank you, Anne. Well done. And also, Paul has given me this. There's only one of these. It's relating to his, One Day, One Church All Together next Saturday at Hindley Park. lots of things going on. And to get tickets, it appears you have to go online. And Paul will do that for you if you can't get online. Won't you, Paul?
It'll be on the table.
And finally, thank you to Henry and to Dan for the service this morning. But finally, birthdays. Now, from what I've heard, we do have one birthday today, and that is Ron. Yay. When is it, Ron? When is it?
Today.
That's amazing today. Is there anybody else?
That was my name.
It's who, sorry?
Jane's
over there. Birthday no. when? This Jane. Week? Tuesday. Lovely. Any more wanting to own up to having a birthday this week? No? Right. So, there we go.
Happy birthday to you. To Jesus be true. May God's Holy Spirit be always with you.
Thank you, David. Christ, who has nourished us with himself, the living bread, make you one in praise and love, and raise you up at the last day. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen.